Well, good evening or good afternoon, depending on when you're watching us. And welcome to another episode of Corner Conversations. I am Paul W. Marino, and my co-host, as usual, is Roger Urban. Well, I brought three books today. One is a history, one is a science fiction, and one is a children's book that I promised to bring in for our director so she can read it with her daughter. And I'm going to start with the history book. I just got this past weekend as we taped this, The Poison Squad. This is about a chemist's single-minded crusade for food safety at the turn of the 20th century. Now, I've had this for a couple of days, and I figure I'm about a quarter of the way into it. And I didn't notice it does have pictures. Woo-ha. But I can sum up what's in this book by reading a poem written by the chemist in question that this is about. It was written by Harvey Washington Wiley in 1899, and he was the chief chemist for the Food and Drug Administration at the turn of the 20th century, and brought about the legislation that created the Pure Food and Drug Act. I wonder what's in it. We sit at a table delightfully spread and teeming with good things to eat, and daintily finger the cream-tinted bread, just needing to make it complete. Excuse me, a film of the butter so yellow and sweet, well suited to make every minute a dream of delight. And yet while we eat, we cannot help asking, what's in it? Oh, maybe this bread contains alum or chalk, or sawdust chopped up very fine, or gypsum and powder about which they talk, terra alba just out of the mine. And our faith in the butter is apt to be weak, for we haven't a good place to pin it. Annatto so yellow and beef fat so sleek, oh, I wish I could know what is in it. The pepper, perhaps, contains coconut shells, and the mustard is cottonseed meal, and the coffee in sooth of baked chicory smells, and the terrapin tastes like roast veal. The wine which you drink never heard of a grape, but of tannin and coal tar is made, and you could not be certain, except for their shape, that the eggs by a chicken were laid. And the salad which bears such an innocent look and whispers of fields that are green is covered with germs, each armed with a hook to grapple with liver and spleen. The banquet, how fine, don't begin it till you think of the past and the future and sigh, how I wonder what's in it. And The things that are in this book are mind-boggling. Formaldehyde added to milk so they could sell milk that was well past its prime. Mm-hmm. People being poisoned and, small doses, it's okay, but no one ever determined what those doses are.
I'm trying to think of the name of the man who almost single-handedly cleaned up the meat industry.
I think it was Upton Sinclair.
Yes, yes. From the time that the cattle went into the butcher shop, so to speak, mm-hmm. till the time that whatever it was came out, like what's in your hot dog, you know? So. It's fascinating, that whole era. It's not only the food, but the drug era going on at the same mm-hmm. time, because you had, you know, Father Paul's or Brother Paul's traveling minstrel show, mm-hmm. and they sold pharmaceuticals, probably made in the day before in the back of his wagon.
Oh, yeah.
You know, so, and who knows what it was made out of, but it was guaranteed to cure
alcohol. Well, alcohol, burnt cork.
A lot of stuff.
Yeah, sometimes floor sweepings.
Many, many, many things went into their pharmaceuticals. It's amazing. I worked in that business for quite some time, until I retired. And people gripe about the price of drugs, as they should. They are expensive. Not knowing really what it costs to put a new drug, especially a new type of drug, on the market. I was there when we introduced the first oral biologic marketed in the United States. It was called Enbrel. It's still on the market today. And I was amazed when they started packing the truck to bring the papers down to the Food and Drug Administration. It was a semi, and it was loaded from front to back with cartons and cartons and cartons of papers. It's absolutely amazing. Costs about $2 to $3 million minimum to get that information together, pay the scientists that worked on it, and then get it down to the FDA. So it's quite a process. That was all started with Upton Sinclair, and rightly so. So I couldn't remember his name for the life of me for a second there. And that was what, in the 20s, I believe?
No, I think it was earlier, maybe the 1890s.
1890s? I know it was early on.
The Jungle.
Yes, yes. And that's quite a book. I read it years and years ago. I can't remember a lot of what's in it. But it's eye-opening, as it was meant to be.
Oh, yes. Yeah. And so is this.
I can believe that. I can believe that. I'll have to write that down and grab a copy whenever I can. It would be interesting to read. Would you like to go on to your second, or would you rather have me go?
No, you may go next.
Okay. My book is called The Berlin Diary by a gentleman named William L. Shirer. You may not be familiar with the name, but the other books he wrote were The Rise and Fall of the Third Reich, which is quite popular, and it's available just about everywhere in every way, shape, or form. And another one that didn't go over quite so well was The Collapse of the Third Republic, and that dealt with the fall of the French government and the fall of France. The French government was so corrupt at that time that they couldn't make a decision to save their souls. But I'm dealing with the Berlin Diary, which is here. It may be available in the library. I have, as you can see, an old copy of it. I've had it since I was in high school. And I've read this thing about three times, and I still find things that, you know, interest me in it. He was a correspondent. He did radio broadcasts, and he also did written correspondence to the New York Herald. And these were made from the late 30s up to and including December 1940. During the same period, from 1934 to the time he was forced to leave Germany, because that's where he was stationed, he was forced to leave in 1940, he wrote a diary, absolutely handwritten diary. And that's what this book is based on, hence the name of the book, The Berlin Diary. During the same period, he was able to hide what he was writing, as he and all other journalists were always under the surveillance of the Gestapo. They checked everything, and quite thoroughly, you might imagine. But it's a compilation of his notes, and it was written, the book itself was written in 1941. It's to me, a fascinating history of the post-World War Germany, and the rise of the Nazis, what brought them about, what was the politic before them, during their initial rise, and afterward. There's no doubt that the Gestapo was aware of his activities, but fortunately for him and for us now, he was able to keep these documents about his observations and keep them from the authorities. He was able to leave Germany along with his notes on December 5th, 1940, interesting date, because that was, after the fall of France and the start of the Battle of Britain. He discusses a great deal about post-World War I Germany and the subsequent rise of Hitler and the Nazis. And I've singled out a single short paragraph to to describe what was going on at the time. And the place of writing of this was Geneva in January 19th. Now, what was going on in January 19th of this particular year, 1939, was the League of Nations. To try to develop the League of Nations, which people say is a precursor to our present
United Nations.
But at this time, this is in January 19th of 1939, and I'm going to read now. The League was in its last death throes, and it's been a sorry sight in the last 4 days. Bonnet and Halifax, here to see that there is no nonsense to delay Franco's victory, Francisco Franco in Spain. Del Vello yesterday made a dignified speech before the council. Halifax, that's Lord Halifax, from Great Britain, to show his colors, got up in the middle of it and ostentatiously strode out. That's all he did. Had a long talk with Del Vello last night. He was depressed, discouraged, and although he did not say so, I gathered it is all up to the Republic, Franco, and his German and Italians, who are now at the gates of Barcelona. Lunch with Edgar Maurer, Nick, these are names that I don't know who these folks are, but apparently confidants and part of his little circle. Much talk, but our side has lost. They were aware at that point that the League of Nations was not going to work. And that's an interesting story in itself. It wasn't put together in such a way to give countries equal access and equal responsibility and equal authority. It was to try to control the major powers at the time, being the United States, Great Britain, France, Germany, and Japan. Interestingly enough, the Russian Revolution had taken place prior to that. Pardon me, I've got a tickle. And not a great deal is said about Stalin and Soviet Russia. But of course, they did play a part in this whole scenario, especially in the three or four years leading up to World War II. I read a little bit that I've typed here. It said he discussed as much about the rise of Hitler and the Nazis, and as well as the reaction of the German people to what was going on. Now, you have to remember that in the 30s, they were really in the midst of a depression, made worse by the fact that the Treaty of Versailles had really strongly punished Germany for, quote, starting the war.
Yeah.
Their economy was in ruins. People didn't have anything to eat. It was just a terrible state of affairs. And he promised them that Germany would rise again.
Hitler.
Hitler did, yes. Finally, he was able to leave Germany. And he commented that certain names of persons in Germany or with relatives in Germany have been discussed in the book or simply indicated by a letter which has no relationship to their real names. The Gestapo will find no clues. And that's a preface of his book. I found it extremely interesting. If you want to read conversations and observations with the German people, the man in the street to some of the Nazis themselves, the higher-ranking Nazis, you'll find it in this book. It's not a difficult read, and I highly recommend it if you can find a copy. It's not a new book. The library may still have one, but I wouldn't promise that.
Well, if you're interested in looking for it, I would suggest abe.com. It's not so much a website in and of itself, but if you're looking for a particular book, if it's listed anywhere, they will find it for you. Mm-hmm. And they can give you a range of prices and and put you in touch with the bookseller.
Mm-hmm. His latter books, especially The Rise and Fall, that's out in paperback, and you can walk into almost any store at any time, or Barnes & Noble, and get a copy of it. This one, I'm not so sure. It's an old book. It was written in the early 30s. Like I said, I came across it when I was in high school at the Adams Library, and my friend and I read through it at least twice. Each of us did it.
Mm-hmm.
And then finally I found a copy and bought it. And at that time, I think I paid a whole $4 at a garage.
Wow.
At a garage sale. And that was expensive for a kid in high school, at that time. It's a fascinating book. There are so many interesting things and interesting people that he's met and worked with and dealt with. I don't think he ever had a meeting with Hitler himself, but he had him right up to the top of that. I mean, with Fat Hering, called him Hering at the time, Hermann Göring, who was the second in command, and he also during the war was the commander in chief of the Luftwaffe, which was the German Air Force. He gives a great picture of why the Nazis succeeded. Mm-hmm. Because the people were so desperate, they had only two places to turn. Actually three, but the third really wasn't much. That was the Weimar Republic. That was the democratic institution set up by the Versailles Treaty. And they couldn't do much to help Germany. The other was the Communist Party, and the third was this upstart party called the National Socialist Workers Party.
Nazis. Yes. And the infamous Beer Hall Putsch.
And the Beer Hall Putsch was well documented in this one, as well as the burning of the Reichstag, which really solidified Hitler's power. The Reichstag was the Capitol building where the German parliament met. The Reichstag was the parliament. And early on in the start of the Nazi Party, there was a mysterious fire that burnt the Reichstag to the ground. And the people were very upset about it because now the government had really had no single place to meet in Berlin. Of course, the Nazis found the culprit. And guess who he was? A young Jew.
Ah, of course.
Had to be a young Jew, or an older Jew, but in this case, a young man. And it was touted that he had indeed started the fire, and he paid the ultimate price for it. That helped them to solidify their power. They found this culprit.
Mm-hmm.
Little did they know that Reichstag meant nothing in a couple of years, because it would be obliterated. It wouldn't be used.
Yeah.
It was, at best, a puppet government for one or two years after that. And he documents this very well. I'd love to have heard some of his radio broadcasts given at the time. They may be recorded somewhere. I'm sure the Library of Congress would have something on it, because this was one direct voice coming from Germany to not only Britain, but to the United States. So I recommend the book. It's very interesting.
I'm reminded of two movies,
mm-hmm.
both comedies. Well, actually, make it three movies, because one of them is Charlie Chaplin's The Great Dictator.
Yes, yes.
And he later said, if they had known how bad things were, it would not have been a comedy. But another is The Tin Drum. Ever heard of it?
Yeah, the name is familiar. I think that was a book as well.
Could be, yeah. It's World War II seen through the eyes of a child. A child is born, and when he comes out, his first impulse is to jump back in again. But his mother says, when he is 2 years old, he shall have a tin drum. And that just sounds so fantastic. He decides to wait around until he's 2 years old. Well, then the tin drum doesn't turn out to be everything he thought it would be. So he decides he will not grow up and throws himself down the cellar stairs so that his parents will have a reason to believe why he's not growing. And there's this wonderful scene. There's a Nazi rally going on, and the crowd is in the stands, and there's a band playing a march, and this little boy gets underneath the stands right next to the band and starts playing his tin drum. He gets a new one every year. And he starts playing his tin drum, and he starts playing to a different rhythm. And the band, which has been playing a march, starts playing a waltz. And all the hands that are up start swaying to the music. And before you know it, the crowd leaves the stand and they're waltzing out in the field. And then when the chief Nazis arrive for the rally and try to get everyone back in their seats, it starts pouring rain. Mm-hmm. And the rally breaks up and the Nazis are left alone in the rain.
Is this Günter Glass? Was that the author's name?
I honestly don't remember.
Because that name rings a bell with me in conjunction with that book. I read that a long time ago. And again, that's an interesting book to read.
Yeah,
it's a different perspective on what was going on. It's fiction.
Yes.
Right, yeah. This is not, but nonetheless, mm-hmm. It's an insight as to what was happening at the time that a lot of people don't understand and don't see. You know, they see the clippings on TV, the series that they had, you know, the rise of the Nazis. And it didn't happen quickly, and it didn't happen without bloodshed, and it almost didn't happen at all. Had people understood that this man was not the Messiah, it would have been all over for him. He had people captivated. Apparently, in German, he was a fantastic speaker. However, if you watch him...
I also know that he won a great number of debates.
Yes.
But he didn't win them honestly. The way that he won was he kept shouting down his opponent, don't let them get a word in edgewise, and that means they cannot present a superior argument.
It sounds familiar. Yeah, sounds familiar. Seen it happen in our own government.
Oh, yes.
Maybe going on now to some degree. Who knows?
Yeah.
But yeah, he was a good orator, apparently, mm-hmm. because he had people mesmerized. And I think I don't know where he took his lessons and his acting ability, his gestures and whatnot, but he did learn about them. This wasn't mm-hmm. self-made. And it's amazing. It really is. You see newsreels of him, and it's comical now that we know more about him, but it's also frightening because people in that day were absolutely mesmerized by the man. And the other interesting part of this book is it dealt with three dictators. Himself, Mr. Hitler, Benito Mussolini, who was the dictator of Italy, and a fascist, and we'll talk about that for a second after, and then Francisco Franco in Spain. When I was in the service, we visited Spain. We ran in, you know, came into port in Spain, and people were still under Franco at the time. He was an old man. The government was changing a little bit, and they were getting a little bit more authority. But with the Caudillo, what he said, the man on horseback, what he said went. The postage stamps had his picture on them. I have a few of them. The coinage mm-hmm. had all had his picture on them. The bills had his picture on them. I don't think they had anything but his picture, all the way, you know, mm-hmm. of everything. And the police, the national police, still wore the uniforms they wore back in the 30s.
Ooh.
Really did. And, you know, he ruled with an iron hand. And then Mussolini, they talk about fascists. People don't know the origin of that word.
Well, actually, I don't either. I know what it means.
Okay. The word was derived from a Roman symbol, which were the fasces.
Oh, yes. Yes. Yeah.
A group of sticks tied together, which they used to beat people with at times. And in the middle of that group of sticks was an axe. So when you see mm-hmm. the fascist symbols, it's a group of sticks tied together with fancy ribbon and an axe.
Yeah, you can see that in Memorial Hall in Adams.
Uh-huh.
And also there's one on the McKinley statue.
Uh-huh.
His left hand is resting on a fasces draped with an American flag.
You used to be, I don't know if you still can, but they were in vogue in Washington. And a lot of the buildings had that symbol because their quote was mm-hmm. a symbol of strength and law. The Roman judiciary were flanked by two gentlemen, supposedly gentlemen, holding the fasces. And when they were in charge, these gentlemen kept the crowds from mobbing the senators or whatever, whoever was giving the legal opinions of the case that they were trying. So that's where that came from. The Nazis were not fascists. They were a little bit different.
Mm-hmm.
The Spanish were a kind of an amalgamation of both the Italian brand of fascism and the German brand. And like I said, even when I was there, and this was, you know, in, God, when was it? In the middle 60s, early 70s?
Mm-hmm.
Francisco Franco still was the boss, and it was well known. And you didn't mess with the Carabinieri in Italy either. But they were not fascist at that time. That had been done away with. So it was a movement that took place in the 30s, especially, you know, having born in Europe because of the effect that the Depression had at that time. Not only in the United States, we think of the Dust Bowl and the poor people and what mm-hmm. have you, but in these countries, it changed governments and changed them drastically. So, he also goes into that in
well, of course, we're seeing elements of it today in America. You know, the people who used to say, my country, right or wrong, well, they're essentially saying whatever the government does is right. Well, that's not democracy, that's fascism.
Yeah, well, some of them are saying that. Not all.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think we have a strong fascist movement in this country, or a neo-fascist, if you want to call it. I don't believe that. I think there are many people who are, how do I want to say it? I don't want to say proud to be Americans, but have their own view of what the government was and would like to mm-hmm. go back to that, you know. Then you have the neo-fascists in this country,
mm-hmm.
and they're not afraid to wear the armband and give the salute and the whole nine yards. And unfortunately, they've grabbed hold of the division between white America and black America and worsened it. Needless to say, they're not in the side of the black Americans. So Again, this stuff can give you a great insight into what's going on today.
Mm-hmm.
You know, even though they're books that were written 40, 50, 60 years ago.
Well, you know, one thing that I find interesting about all this is the swastika. Because if you look at the history of the swastika, it used to be a symbol of luck.
Mm-hmm.
And go over to Williams College, there is a building there with a swastika on it. Pittsfield Cemetery, there's a mausoleum that's essentially a little Byzantine cathedral. And it has swastikas all around it. There were many different kinds of swastikas, including a Jewish swastika. And of course, now it's all anathema.
Mm-hmm. There were also some that were turned the opposite direction. If you look at the Nazi swastika, the lower arm that goes up like so, is usually on the left. Interesting. And the other arm goes up to the right. Meaning what? I don't know. There's also an American Indian symbol.
I did not know that.
Yes, yes. I mean, I don't know what the origins of this thing were. You find them all over the Scandinavian heritage had what they call runes, R-U-N-E-S, runes.
Yes.
And they were symbols. And this was part of a language and what have you. The Germans actually took some of these runes and modified them. The Nazis did. The SS symbol is actually two runes, which is a lightning bolt, not an S. But they were the German name for what their organization was the Sturmgeschütz. And that's SS. I was into this for a long time. World War II is still a very interesting thing for me. But the most interesting thing is what was going on in the rest of the world. We know what was happening in Germany because it's been studied ad nauseum.
Mm-hmm.
I wrote a paper in college, which I didn't get graded very well on, called The Rise of Japanese Fascism. And the professor there, who was a army officer at the, prior to his going into education, was going to fail me on it. And he called me in into his office and we had a chat. And he said, what made you think that the Japanese were fascist? And I pulled out a book called The Rise of Japanese Fascism. Mm-hmm. He says, are you telling me you plagiarized? I said, no. But I took some of the ideas there and tried to expand on it. I said, so there was a division in Japan prior to World War II. There were fascists or fascist-like. South America, Argentina, for example, was fascist. Probably still is to some degree. Evita and her wonderful husband.
Oh, yes.
So that period of time had a great impact on us. It still does. If you want to get under somebody's skin, you call them a fascist today. The police, they're fascists. Why? Because they uphold the law and wear uniforms.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Are there good cops and bad cops? Sure. They're good everything and bad everything. I mean, we're humans. You're not going to find this level of goodness in certain groups and not in others. It's ridiculous. But he gives a great insight as to what the common people were going through. If you read his second book, which was The Rise and Fall of the Third Reich, he brings in a lot of these factors together. Mussolini, Stalin, not so much Franco, but if you read the history of the war that Franco started, against the Republic of Spain, the Republicans, you'll find that the Germans and the Italians both helped Franco win that war by the use of their aircraft and men. A lot of people don't know that. Europe, the First World War did a lot to damage Europe, damage it badly.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean all of Europe, Russia, the lower continent, I call it the lower continent, Spain, Germany, France, Italy, Greece. Some of them succumbed to a fascism or fascist-like government, and some didn't. The stalwart in all of it was Britain. France had their problems.
Mm-hmm.
While they still had a free and a interesting democracy, it was challenged to a great deal. And in that book, The Collapse of the Third Republic, talks all about it. The Third Republic was France's Third Republic. The first was under Napoleon. And the Third Republic was quite corrupt, quite corrupt. And they believed that since they had won World War I, they had won it. No one else, mm-hmm. they did.
Oh, of course.
Yeah, and they had built this magnificent line of fortifications to separate Germany from France, called the Maginot Line, which cost them dearly as far as money, but it helped during the Depression because it gave work to the people who would have normally been out of work. And come to find out that it only stretched from the borders of France and Germany, which were congruent together.
Mm-hmm.
When you got up to Belgium and the Netherlands, it didn't exist.
Didn't need it anymore.
And then when it got down to Switzerland, of course, it wasn't there, but it didn't go that far. It went to the Ardennes Forest because they believed that no army could pass through there. Wrong. Wrong. There's a German general named Heinz Guderian, who was a tank officer. He was in charge of the tanks, mm-hmm. and that's where they came through. The French didn't know what the heck to do, completely dumbfounded. So that's, to me, this is a fascinating period, and we're still seeing the some of the results of what went on, both prior to the war and especially after the war. To see the what happened in Germany today, especially since the reunification of Germany, it's amazing. I mean, they are more democratic than we are in some ways.
Mm-hmm.
And Italy, poor Italy, just never really recovered. It's still an interesting country, but not a powerhouse.
Mm-hmm.
Britain survives.
Hanging on, but tooth and nail.
Yep. Britain ruled the sea and still has a strong navy, but there's nothing in the world on the sea that compares to the United States Navy. Nothing. It's huge. It's multifaceted, and God help anybody that tries to go against it. Not just because I was in the Navy, but...
I understand.
It's we rule the oceans.
Well...
Second book. Carl Sagan.
Yes, second book is Carl Sagan's novel, Contact. I really like this novel. It's written from a... Whoops, there we go. It's written from a scientist's perspective, mm-hmm. as to how we would be contacted. And what he sees is somewhere out in space, there is a planet that is covered with radio telescopes, constantly searching the sky for signals. Well, a signal comes from Earth. The very first television broadcast. They receive it and they send it back with something hidden in the file. So when the first signal from space reaches us, oh, it's three-dimensional, it's a TV signal, and it's Hitler and the Nazis, because that was the very first television broadcast in the world. And what's embedded in the signal are the instructions for building a machine capable of traveling through a stable wormhole so that we can go and meet the people that put all the radio telescopes on that planet. And then, having visited there, well, there's a door there that they can go through, and everyone meets someone from their past they most want to see. And the young woman who is the protagonist through most of this story, she misses her stepfather severely, and he is the one that's waiting to talk to her. And it's not really her stepfather from her childhood, he's dead, but it's someone appearing as her stepfather who can talk to her and tell her about the culture. And when they come back, no time has passed, essentially. They've gone through a wormhole to somewhere else in the galaxy, and they come back and you just left. And then the machine doesn't work, so they can't go back again. But, you know, it's, you know, we're out there. We're very interested in human development. Mm-hmm. We prefer acts of loving kindness.
Most of us, yes.
Yeah, so before we are going to allow further contact, you're going to have to straighten yourselves out. You are going to have to stop practicing war. You know, oh goodness, that reminds me of an episode of The Dark Side where a spaceship, a sphere, appears in the sky. It comes down, and I think it's at the United Nations. The guy appears, and he tells them that we created your race, and we've decided to destroy you. You know, our ships are arriving in 24 hours. Well, why? Well, you have a small talent for war. Well, you know, please give us another chance. Well, I don't know what you can accomplish in 24 hours, but you have the 24 hours. And so they argue and struggle, but when the guy shows up 24 hours later, they hand him a book. Here it is, a comprehensive plan for world peace. And he looks through that, and he starts chuckling. They look at each other. He starts laughing. They start laughing. He laughs. They laugh. He stops laughing. They're still laughing. You don't understand. We breed warriors to fight for us across space. When I said you have a small talent for war, your fighting is disorganized. You know, you're not getting together to fight. You're just being very lackadaisical about it. But one thing about you is you do have a grand sense of the absurd. And he beams back up to his ship, and all the other warships come down to blast us to oblivion.
Okay. Interesting.
That has nothing to do with this book, but it is a very well-written book. And we have about 13 minutes left, so I'm moving on to my third book,
okay.
Ten in a Bed. And in fact, I'm going to stick it over here. And there is my disembodied arm there. Woo! This is a British book about a little girl named Dinah Price. And I promised to bring this in for Nicole so that she can read it with her daughter. This little girl, I think she's supposed to be about 6 years old. She goes through her day doing what she does. She goes to school. She comes home. She pets the dog. She plays with her baby brother, Maurice. And when she goes upstairs to bed, she finds some fairy tale character or characters in her bed. The first night she goes up, there are three bears in her bed, pretending to be asleep. And before they will go home and get into their beds so that she can get into her bed, she has to tell them a story, and it has to be a good one. And so she is forced to tell them a variation on the three bears, in which the bears are the good guys. And then they climb out the window and they go home. And the next morning she gets up, she has cereal with the top of the milk on it. And if you're wondering what that means, when you and I were kids, milk was delivered door to door, and a bottle of whole milk had a layer of cream about that thick. And my mother always shook the bottle. But in Great Britain, where milk is still delivered door to door, that layer of cream is the top of the milk. So she has her cereal with the top of the milk on it. She has an orange. She has a bite of her dad's toast. And then she goes to school where she meets her friend, tells her about the three bears, and her friend says, "Oh, I had four bears in my bed once." And she draws a picture of the three bears in her activity book. And her teacher, Mrs. Hicks, says, "That's very nice, dear." She has lunch, and we hear what she had for lunch, Cumberland pie and peas and so on. And she comes home, has tea, pets the dog, plays with her baby brother, Maurice, goes upstairs to bed, where she finds a wicked witch. "Here, you get good stories around here." And
you do that well.
Thank you. Hey, I used to read to my nieces and nephews.
I believe that.
And I come from a theatrical background, too. So this has one of the best lines in it ever written anywhere. I dare you to find a better line than this. The last chapter is titled Little Girl Sandwich. She goes upstairs and finds a giant in her bed. He's rather small as giants go, but he's spilling out of the bed, and he has a picnic basket next to him, and he takes out a cruet stand with oil and vinegar, and he's got some salt and pepper, and he takes out something like a Tupperware container containing two huge slices of buttered bread. And he's interested in having a little girl sandwich. "I haven't had a little girl sandwich in so long. Ooh, I ought to make a wish." Well, she tries telling him a story. He's not interested. She offers him things, her dolls, her toys. No, he wants a sandwich. And she can't get out the door because his foot has just fallen against it. She starts screaming for help, and she tells him, "You can't eat me. Why not? My poor old mother will be all alone." "No, she won't. She's not old, for a start. Besides, whose are all those nappies out on the clothesline?" Meaning diapers. "Oh, well, they're my baby brother Maurice's." "Aha! You ought to be ashamed of yourself." He waves his finger at her. Looks like a policeman's truncheon. And he tells her, "You ought to be ashamed of yourself telling fibs at your age. But you come and lie down in this sandwich, which I have all ready for you, and we'll say no more about it." "No! Sandwich? Sandwich." So she starts calling for help. And he keeps telling her to be quiet. "You'll upset you'll wake up your baby sister, brother, help! And he keeps reaching for it. He could do it if he got out of bed, but he can't. Well, when all seems lost, her baby brother starts crying. She looks at the giant, and the giant looks at her, and they both have guilty expressions on their faces. And she says, "You started it." "No, you started it. You were going to eat me. I still am. Help!" "All right, all right." He wonders why no one's coming to take care of the baby. Well, her big brother is watching TV with his friends, and her parents are out front building a rockery, which I take to mean a rock garden. And, well, the poor kid sounds like he's about to explode in there. And she says, "Well, I could go. I could get him to stop. Here comes the line." "No, you'd go and that'd be the last I'd see of you. I've had sandwiches run off from me before." Where can you find a better line than that? And it calls to mind such an interesting image, a sandwich running away. Well, he finally gives in and lets her go and comfort the baby. And he's tangled up in his blanket. She untangles the blankets and she offers him his finger, which he immediately puts in his mouth. And she plays with him a little and he goes back to sleep. She goes downstairs and looks out the window until her parents see her and tell her, "Hey, what are you doing? Get back to bed. There's a giant in my bed. Tell him to move over." So she goes into the kitchen. She gets a leftover cheese and tomato flan and half an apple pie. And she goes upstairs and the giant isn't in her room anymore. He's standing outside the window. And, well, he couldn't eat her now even if he wanted to because he's eaten his bread and butter. And he puts a trilby hat on his head. And she brought him this cheese and tomato flan. "Well, I make it have to get used to things like this." "It's not bad." And she brought him half an apple pie. It looks like a Smartie in his hand, one of those individual fruit pies. "Not bad." And he's getting ready to go. And she asks him, "How did you get out the window?" "The same way I got in, with difficulty." And he walks off into the night, and her mother comes in. "This bed is a mess. The giant did it." "Oh, and I suppose the giant ate this flan and the apple pie." "Yes, he did. And if you don't believe me, there he is." And they look, and there's something in the distance that might be a giant or might be something else entirely. Well, there was a giant, yes. Her mother gets her into bed, and well, there was a witch, and there was a wolf, and this and that, and the other thing. "Yes, now go to sleep." And she goes to sleep, and sleeps until morning. And it's such a beautiful book.
It's a little strange, but yeah.
Yeah, it is strange, but it's strange in a good way.
Well, yeah. Well, think about the fairy tales we learned when we were kids.
Yeah.
Some of them were scary.
Oh, yes. Yeah.
But good. They always had a good moral.
Mm-hmm. Be a good boy or
patrol.
Not necessarily always a good moral.
Well, most of the time.
But, yeah.
Be good or the troll will eat you, you know. That's sort of.
Mm-hmm. And, of course, Hansel and Gretel. Did I tell you why I think Hansel and Gretel is so important for kids to read?
I think we talked about that maybe in the first show.
Yeah, first show. Well, we have 4 minutes left.
Well, good. What shall we discuss? Certainly not current events. Certainly not current
events. Oh, absolutely not current events.
No. Unless they relate just to North Adams, I could live with that. Interesting things happening in our neighborhood, so to speak.
Mm-hmm.
Interesting things.
Well, actually, if we're all out of things to discuss, why don't we just sign off?
Sounds like a wiener to me.
All right. Thank you for joining me again. Thank you for joining us. And be sure to join us again next week when we will be back with another Corner Conversations. Thank you.
good night, or goodbye, or whatever.